Last video we have seen how we can identify the central tendency of a dataset, and in this video we will talk about how we can describe the dataset in respect to the spread of their data. So you can see here are several datasets that have probably the same central tendency, so the same mean value, but they look totally different in respect how they are spread on the x-axis. For example, here we have a spread from 45 to 45 negative positive, while here we have something which spreads from minus 15 to 15. And of course, these are different distributions with different parameters, and this time we want to see how we can describe these parameters. And the most easiest thing is probably to identify the most extreme values here. So the minimum value and the maximum value, and also in that case here the minimum and maximum, and we can then see already a difference between both of these data sets. Let's go to our studio and see how we can do that. And I've prepared a bit, which I now removed already again. So at first, always we have to see if we are in the right folder with get WD, and I can see that I'm currently in session 11, but I want to go to session 4, and to do so I say set WD, and I can use relative paths, so I want to go one level up, and then to session 03, and now when I look at get WD, you can see that I'm in the right folder, and I also could say or use the dir command to see the content of that folder, and that looks perfectly right for now. Okay, now we can load this Münsingen Fibula dataset, and in there we have the fibula length as one of the columns, and I can access that column by Münsingen dollar length. And here are the values of the lengths of our fibulas. Okay, how is this distribution? How does this distribution look like? Probably you remember from graphical display, I can make a histogram of the data set, and I can see kind of its distribution. I also could use that in respect to probability equals to true. So I get here a density value on the y-axis, and I can add to that lines of the density of our data set, and then we get this nice little density plot, and you can see here already there's this distribution has a specific shape with two outliers here that kind of distort the whole distribution. And if I would now look for the maximum and the minimum value, this would strongly be influenced by these two outliers here. So the maximum value will be quite high, although most of the data are more centered around something here. But still, we can calculate the minimum value by using the min command and putting the variable in the specific column in there, and the minimum value is 26, and the same can be achieved for the maximum value by the max command, and then we see the maximum value is 128. You can also do both at the same time with the command range, and not range of min but range of that here, and now you can see both values at the same time, 26 as the minimum and 128 as the maximum value. So this very much depends on the extreme values here. Of course, we are looking for the extreme values. One measure that might be a bit more not so much determined by the maximum values and give us more information about the general spread of the data, you probably remember the box plot. And when I do the box plot here, we have the box here describing half, the middle half of the data, and the two outliers are marked here. And to get the range of the box here, I can use the command EQR, which means interquartile range. And I paste my variable in here and get a number of 15, which means this box here is 15 units wide or high here. And with that, we have already an information about the spread. I go back to the density plot that describes more the whole range of the data here. So it's more centered around the mean and it's not so much influenced by the outliers. But probably you want to have a, or more usual is a measurement of the distribution of the spread of the data that respects all the values together. And one could imagine that we need the mean of the deviation from the mean to have an idea how all the data are spread. To give you an example here, I can just copy paste a bit of code to achieve that. So I plot the values of our individual data here and I identify the mean here. And what we now would like to have are all the distances from the mean for all individual values and calculate the mean distance from the mean, which gives us an information about how all the data in the mean are spread around the mean value. And this is a quite good estimation for the central tendency. So to achieve that, we can take our values and subtract from them the mean of these values. So the mean of these values is 57. And if we subtract every individual values from this 57, we can see how much the values are below or above the mean value. The thing is, if I take this now and calculate the mean of that, I get something that's close to zero. Actually, it is zero. And the only reason why this deviates is because of rounding errors. And it's clear because the mean is centered through all the values here. And so if we sum up the negative and positive distances, we get zero because that's the definition of the mean. So at first we have to get rid of the sign here to get the mean distance in absolute terms. And of course I could use an abs command to get the absolute number, but this mathematician as such usually likes to get rid of the sign by just squaring the result of a calculation. So if I do square here, you can see all the signs are gone and now we have only positive values and I can sum them up and divide them by the length of my data set. And now I have a mean distance in square units for all the distances from the mean. So now we have already something which can express the spread of the data. And this measurement is called the variance. So if I, there's a specific command for that, if I do var my data set, I get more or less the same value, but you can see there's a deviation from that. And the reason for that is that the variance, the empirical variance, is defined as not dividing by the length, but by the length minus one. And if I add that here, now I have the same value as R calculates with the variance command. So that's the empirical variance. And that's what you usually are using when you talk about a sample. Okay, but now we have the inconvenient situation here that the length are in centimeter, but our variance is in square centimeter, and this also gives you the square mean distance from the mean. And this is easily solvable if we just take the square root. Of our variance, then we have something that's exactly the mean distance of all the values from the mean and also is in the same units as the actual measurements. So this says the values are centered around the mean value with a mean distance of 25 centimeter or millimeter actually. So now we have an indication how this whole distance can be expressed, or the spread of the data can be expressed by one specific value, and that's the most common used value for that, so it's called the standard deviation. I would also like to show you shortly the formulas by copy pasting a bit here and do some magic. So the variance is defined as the mean distance from the mean squared, the sum of that divided by the number of cases minus one. And then we have the standard deviation, which is the square root of the variance. So the same formula here, just adding a square root there. There's a third thing, and that's this one here. Where we take the standard deviation and divide that by the mean of the data set. And the reason for that is if we like to compare different things, of course the standard deviation is in the same units like the measurements, and it is also depending on the range of the data, the magnitude of the data. So if we have a large mean value, also the standard deviation will be quite large in absolute values, while if we have a small mean, also the standard deviation usually should be rather smaller. And to compare different values with different means, you need to normalize that according to the mean of the different values. For example, if we would like to see if our fibula differ more in respect to their length than they are differing in respect to the foot length, we would like to normalize the standard deviation to the square root. To the means. So let's do that. The command for standard deviation in R is SD, and I take my length of the values here, so 25 like we have calculated before, or to be more precise around about 26, and we can do the same for the foot length, and the foot length seems to be smaller, but also the mean of the foot length is smaller than the mean of the length of the fibulas. You can see much smaller. So to compare both, we have to divide that by the mean of the length in case of the length and by the mean of the foot length. Case of the foot length, and if we do that, we can see that the variation coefficient of the length is smaller than the variation coefficient of the foot length, which means the length of the fibula is more standardized than the foot length of these fibulas. So with that, we have all three standard expressions of distribution of spread of data available. You can easily calculate the variance. The most common used is the standard deviation, which normalize square root the result of a variance so that we get a measurement that's in the same units as the actual measurements and describes you the mean distance from the mean. And if you want to like to compare different data sets with different means, you might like to calculate the variation coefficient to have something that's unitless and that can be compared. across different variables.